Hello, we from INFORS welcome you all to the second series of INFORS webinars. My name is Lea Düppe and I'm here today with my colleague Kolwan Kandra. We are both product managers at INFORS.
Hi, I'm Kolwan and a warm welcome also from my side to this webinar.
Today we would like to share with you 5 tips on how to increase biomass in your shakers. The first one is rather obvious, is to even start shaking. The second tip we will discuss is how to choose the right speed and throw for your shaker. The third tip is do not overfill your culture vessel and which is the optimal filling volume for your application. Fourthly, it is important to minimize interruptions and how to fulfill this point. And finally, the fifth tip is to keep your shaker under control no matter where you are. So let us begin by starting to shake. My colleague will discuss why shaking is better than having a static culture.
So thanks, Lea, for this nice introduction. So many of you most probably apply static culture for either clone selection, testing out culturing conditions, or even investigating hosts. And another reason for deciding to run static condition compared to shaking conditions is the risk of shear stress, especially for cell culture applications. So during static culturing, the cells settle down to the bottom and the gas transfer only takes place via diffusion, as we are showing here. So this sounds like a very easy way to cultivate cells, but in this way you will encounter the formation of gradients. This means that the high concentration of carbon dioxide as well as product concentration and waste concentrations are generated at the bottom, because this is where the cells are settled down. Wherefore, oxygen and nutrition are mostly available at the surface of the flask, as shown here and here. So such conditions do not allow ideal availability of oxygen within the culture, and of course more limitations are likely to occur. Looking at the function and the purpose of shaking, you will see that the cells are permanently in motion and they are kept in suspension. And this, of course, will lead to a larger surface to volume ratio, which will benefit oxygen transfer in your culture media and the release of carbon dioxide. Furthermore, the shaking of your culture provides homogeneous conditions, of course, within the culture media itself, and you will have no gradients. Questions which arise are here that how to decide on the right shaking throw as well as speed for your shaking flasks. And here my colleague Lea is going to discuss that in more detail. So Lea, it's your turn.
Thanks, Kolwan. Often the reason for poor biomass concentration is not the clone, as you may think. External factors such as shaking throw in combination with the shaking speed have a big influence on the oxygen transfer. Here we show a computational fluid dynamics, so-called CFD study, of mixing and gas liquid mass transfer on a shaking flask shaked at 200 RPM. CFDs simulate the flow of the fluid and the interaction of the fluid with the surfaces. The results provided an increase of surface of a shaken flask, as you can see here. In consequence, with high shaking speeds, a higher transfer can be reached because the liquid surface gets larger. However, while increasing the speed, it must be considered that cells might suffer shear stress. For bacteria, the maximum speed is limited by the fixing mechanism of the flask on the tray and, of course, by the spilling of the liquid. Moreover, we would like to share with you another example which illustrates the dependency of shaking speed and oxygen transfer. For efficient mass transfer and optimal cell growth in small wells like deep well plate and microtiter plates, as you can see here, a high-speed mixing and small shaking orbits are required. So here you can see we have a 3 mm shaking throw for the microtiter plates and a maximum speed of 1000 RPM. And you can see that the liquid only starts swirling at 600 RPM. But if we look at the picture at 1000 RPM, we see a much larger surface of the liquid, which means we have a much better oxygen transfer. And with this table, we have listed different recommendations for our incubation shaker Multitron. So in general, 25 millimeter is always a good choice and can yield excellent results independent of the application. However, in some cases, restrictions in respect of oxygen transfer and cell growth will occur, and a better result can be achieved if the shaking flow is selected according to the application. So for example, 3 millimeters or 50 millimeters. So we have summarized a rule of thumb, which can be followed within a specific shaking throw. So the 25 millimeter throw is recommended for flask sizes from 25 milliliters up to 2 liters. And the bigger throw is recommended for bigger flasks. So for flask size from 2 liters to 5 liters, and for cell culture that is sensitive to shear stress. And last but not least, micro titer and deep well plates, as we just saw on the last slide. So we could recommend a 3 millimeter throw with shaking speeds of 1000 RPM. To give you an example, we would like to show you suitable shaker settings for microbial application, which are the following. So the shaking speed is mainly around 300 RPM. For bacteria, yeast, or fungi, depending on the application. And as just mentioned, we use mostly 25 millimeter shaking diameter for microorganisms. If you would like to learn more about typical cultivation conditions, especially for cell culture, we recommend our blog post, which you will find on our website. Another very important factor which has a big influence on the oxygen transfer and therefore the cell growth is the filling volume of the flask. And Kulwan, can you please explain this point for us?
A typical shake flask is usually filled between 25 to 30% of its working volume. And this is enough for processes that just aim to generate biomass or for certain cultures such as microaerophilic or slow-growing organisms. And as you can see here in this figure, the higher the filling volume, the smaller the surface gets. This will, of course, lead to an insufficient oxygen transfer, as we mentioned before. Moreover, a high filling volume will also reduce the liquid movement within the flask, due to the angled sides of the flasks. And if you wish actually to have no oxygen transfer limitation, we would rather suggest you to reduce the working volume to 10% of the total shake flask volume. And as you can show within, as you can see within this shake flasks here, a smaller volume will smear the whole culture in a thin layer on the sides of the flask while shaking. Other flask geometries, such as the Fernbach flask, allow more oxygen transfer per volume, actually, as twice as high. But as visible here, they will need much more space compared to Erlenmeyer flasks, which are generally used for cultivating cells. Here, we would like to show you the consequences of too high filling volumes. And I want to present you a research example from Jäger and colleagues, which shows the oxygen concentration depending on different filling volumes. So they used from 200 milliliters to 500 milliliters, and they were looking for insect cell growth. And the results here indicate, as well, they support the points which we mentioned earlier, that higher filling volumes, which is the red dark line here, of course show a very sharp decrease of oxygen transfer within the culture compared to smaller filling volumes. And if you look on the right side, the same applies actually for microtiter and deep well plates, which can be shown to a very easy demonstrated mixing experiment. So the wells were filled with a sugar and blue dye solution and then shaken. And the wells with a very low filling volume show that they are completely mixed and have a, and you can, you achieve a very homogeneous solution after shaking. Whereas if you look at the high filling wells, you see that there are still two phases. So, so far we explained to you the right flow, the speed, as well as the filling volume, but of course there are more influencing factors. Lea, can you please explain that to us?
Yes, of course. Thank you, Kulwant. In shakers, we see that there is less online monitoring information available compared to bioreactors, and therefore collecting data from them may require frequent removal from the growth environment. Every time the incubation shaker door is opened to access a flask, heat is lost and the shaking action is halted. Doing this occasionally will not make much difference, but you should avoid repeated door opening or taking the flask out for a longer time, because this most likely will skew your results and will hinder the optimal cell growth. But there are several things which can mitigate these negative effects, and this I will present you now. So the first possibility is, or the first thing that will decrease the interruption time, is the ability to rapidly stop and restart the shaking speed of the shaker. So a good example for this is shown in this video of the multitron. So as we see, the braking is very fast, but we see no spilling of the liquid in the flask, but a smooth slowing down. Moreover, it is important that the shaker returns fast to the set point after interruption through door opening, as we can see here in this second video. The second possibility to minimize shaking interruption is to use online measurement of biomass concentration, for example, with the Aquia Biolabs cell growth quantifier, also called CGQ. This product provides high data density, which allows a detailed process monitoring for microorganisms at any given time. Then, in addition, no manual sampling to measure biomass is necessary, which saves a lot of hands-on time. And since it is a real-time measurement, it allows you to react quickly on any deviations. We also provide a white paper and a blog post about this solution on our website, as you can see here. Then the third tip I have for you to minimize the interruption time is to reduce door openings of the shaker due to automatic feeding, for example, using the Aquila Biolabs liquid injection system, also called LIS. And this system is compatible with various substances, for example, sugar solutions, buffers, or alcohols. And you can choose from customizable feeding profiles. So you can program either single shot, multi-shot, or even exponential feeding. This opens a range of fed batch and continuous process possibilities without the manual applications and cultivations interruption. There are more advantages of automated liquid addition, which are described in this white paper, and you can download it for free on our website. And the liquid injection system is also, can also be controlled by the software Eve. And this already brings me to our last tip to increase biomass: to monitor and control the shaker from everywhere you are. Especially in times like these, when the access to the lab might be limited, this can be very helpful for the success of your experiments. And Kulwant, can you please give us more details on this fifth tip?
Of course, Lea. As Lea already mentioned, in the situations which we are experiencing currently, access to the lab might be limited. But even in scenarios where lab access is not restricted, it is important to have the ability to control and monitor your processes precisely in a shaker. And therefore, Eve, a bioprocess software platform, provides all necessary features which are required for a successful cultivation. So firstly, the ability of modern real-time monitoring. That means that you can have a comprehensive overview of all your running batches. So you can control if all your shakers are really running on a specific set point. And if not, you would get an alarm. Furthermore, you can display all variables, that means online, at-line, on a single personalized chart. And it's also, of course, possible to add any measurement values which you get through offline samples. And of course, it's also possible to monitor any number of screens, that means in your lab or at home. And you can, of course, if you want, give access to your colleagues. And the second very important feature is the powerful batch control. And what this allows is to create intuitively complex batch strategies and phases, such as, for example, for fed batch processes, or if you want to have automatic induction of your culture. And it is possible to fully automate your batch strategy. Of course, you can also intervene manually during your process at any time. For example, if you must have to cool down the end of your process, since the cells have achieved a specific cell density, but of course it's Sunday and you cannot or you don't want to go to the lab, so you can use this function and then harvest your cells, for example, on Monday. We explained to you now and we discussed all the basic five tips how to increase successfully the biomass in your shaker. And if you have any more questions regarding the software I just mentioned, or you want any feedback or knowledge, or have questions regarding our shakers, you are most welcome to visit our website.
You will find also all the blog posts and white papers we mentioned during this webinar. And in addition, we also offer a free download of our cookbook, which contains basic concepts, recipes, and strategies for shaker cultivations involving cell cultures and microorganisms.
Yes, and we really hope that this webinar was informative. And if you want to keep updated, please follow us on LinkedIn and Facebook, or just recently added Instagram, to get all the news regarding our next webinars, blog posts, or any products we offer.
And please feel free to contact us anytime if you need further support. So we from INFORS say thanks for watching. Take care.